Hello everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video I'm going to show you how you can easily reset your database data when you run your tests against it. Usually they're going to be integration tests, but if you have something like acceptance tests or BDD, things like this can also use what we're going to see in this video. If you like the type of content and you want to see more, make sure you subscribe, ring the notification bell, and for more training, check out nickchapsas.com. Now, before I move on, quick reminder that we'll be running my 2-day workshop From Zero to Hero, Effective Testing in C# in a few conferences this year. For now, these are the confirmed ones, with more being confirmed as we go. It is a 2-day in-person workshop where I sit down with you and we go through unit testing, integration testing, mutation testing, and performance testing, and we see best practices and real-world examples like the ones I'm going to show you in this video right now. So don't miss a chance to attend one. If you can, speak with your manager, and I hope to see you there. All right, so let me show you what I have here. I have a project over here, an API that we basically have seen before. This is your traditional CRUD REST API. So we have a create endpoint to create a customer, a get to get by ID, a get all to get all the customers, a put to update a customer, then a delete to delete a customer. And we're writing integration tests against this API. So let's go ahead and see what our tests look like. Here I have my customer controller integration tests, and I'm using an iClass fixture, which is an XUnit thing. And in that class fixture, my shared resource is the API factory, the customer API factory, which is just an extension of the web application factory. All this really does is it spins up an in-memory version of my real API targeting real databases and real dependencies. And then I'm using all the setup over here to make it point to a database in Docker. Now, it really depends on how you're running your tests. For example, you might have one single database, like a staging database or an integration database, and you use that. Maybe you create a database for your tests, maybe on the cloud, and you point there. There's many ways to deal with this issue. Now, for the purposes of simplicity of the video, I'm going to spin up a database here using test containers, which is something I've actually talked in a separate video. I'm going to put a link to that at the top right corner of your screen right now. If you want to check it later, not now, but just know that on startup, this will actually create a real Postgres database in Docker in here. And then this can just run the tests, and I have the same setup for everything. Now, what you should know is each class will run its tests in parallel, meaning that since I have 5 classes, I'm going to create 5 servers and 5 databases. Let's go ahead and run this just to see everything being run against real systems. So first I'm going to go into the tests tab over here and find my tests, and I'm going to just run all of them. And as I'm running them, I'm also going to show you what's happening here. So as you can see, a watchdog service was spun up, and then 5 databases were created. Now they're exited, and then they're going to go just disappear after some seconds. And as you can see, all my tests passed. These tests do call a real database. Well, in this case, 5. Now, this took 2.5 seconds, which for 10 tests, which is integration tests calling the database, it is not horrible, but it is not really amazing. And also, what happens if you have 10 of those or 50 of those classes? Well, you're going to spin up 50 databases, which is not great. So an approach that many people try to follow is actually share a database and a web application factory instance for all of the tests, which is a great approach. So we're going to go ahead and refactor it to do that. Now in XUnit, what you need is something called a collection fixture. So I'm going to go ahead and create a new class, and I'm going to call it shared test collection. And that's going to implement the iCollection fixture. And then the item I need in here is the same shared context that every item, every class in my collection, my test collection, will reuse, meaning I'm going to reuse the same API and the same database. And then all I need to do is add a collection definition up here and say that this is my test collection or shared test collection. The reason why I do that is because now I can go to my test, and instead of saying, hey, extend the iClass fixture with this type, I'm going to remove that and instead say collection, and then I'm going to use the name of my shared test collection, which is test collection, and I'm just going to put it here. And now this, I'm going to go ahead and do this for all of my other test classes. So this goes here, and I'm going to do it off camera for the rest. Here we go. And now if I go ahead now and I run my tests again, and I quickly show you Docker, then we only going to see one database being created, not 5, because now everything is sharing the same application. Now we notice 2 things. everything was way, way faster. Remember, we're at around 2.5 seconds before. Now we're at 724 milliseconds. However, 2 tests failed. These tests failed because the other tests did not really clean the data they created. And if we go over here to see how the get all tests were written, they implement this iasync lifetime interface, and then we have these IDs to delete, which as we're adding things in here, they're being later deleted in this dispose async method. So we kind of did a bit of a management of the data we created because get all returns all. And if you have data by other tests, you're going to have clashes. Now, by default in XUnit, in a configuration like this, every test will run sequentially. So each test will have its time to create its data and delete its data. And I could go ahead and do all that sort of management for my create endpoint, where I'm creating a new user and then say, okay, you created something, now let's go ahead and delete it, and so on. But this will be very, very tedious, and you won't always have all the information you need to know exactly what to delete on the database level. And this is where a library called Respawn comes in. Now, Respawn is made by Jimmy Bogert, the same person who made AutoMapper and Mediator, but don't worry, people like this library. And Respawn, in a fairly sophisticated way, does a very, very simple thing. It resets the state in your database. So it observes it, creates some SQL, and then when you say reset the database to a previous point, it will run that SQL and then truncate, delete, do whatever it needs to make sure it's in the same state you want it for your tests. So what we're going to do is capture the state after the migrations in the beginning of the application, and then after each test, reset the state. And then we won't have to worry about things like how we delete data or how we deal with data, none of that. Respawn will do all that for us. Now, you know how it goes in this channel. We really support open source. So if you like Respawn and you think what it's doing is cool, then I highly recommend you check the link in the description, and you go on GitHub and you give it a star. It is just a click, but it really means a lot to those open source creators creating those projects for us, especially Jimmy, because he made Mediator and AutoMapper and everyone hates it. All right, so let's go ahead and add Respawn into the project. So I'm going to go ahead here and search for Respawn. It is this package over here. I'm going to add it. And Respawn supports multiple adapters. In this case, I'm using Postgres. So it has a Postgres adapter. If you're using MS SQL or whatever else, it's probably supported. If it's not, you can see how an adapter is implemented and then implement your own. And then I'm going to go into my API factory and do a bit of a refactoring, because currently in my tests, each one of them is creating a new client from the API factory, which isn't necessarily bad, but we don't need to. We can reuse the same API client. So the first thing I want to do is I want to expose an HTTP client over here, call it HTTP client, and I'm going to have a private setter. And I'm just going to say that, yeah, this is not going to be null actually. And I'm going to initialize it in the initialize async method, which is called once for all the tests, because this is used on the shared context. So all I'm going to say is HTTP client equals create client. So the same client now will be reused as long as I go here and I say that, hey, use the HTTP client here, don't create a new one. And I'm going to go ahead and do this for all of the other classes. All right, and that is done. And now what I want to do is go ahead and configure my responder. So I need two things. First, I need my database connection, and then I need a responder instance. So I'm going to say private DB connection here, because that's what responder accepts. And I'm going to say DB connection, and this is definitely not null. And then I'm going to create a private responder instance over here, call it responder. Same thing. This is definitely not going to be null. The reason why I'm doing this is because I'm not initializing them in the constructor. I'm initializing them in the initialize async method. And what I need is, after I have my database started, I'm going to say DB connection equals new Postgres connection. I'm going to point to that through my DB container. This is where you would put your connection string for your database connection, the test database. And then after I have my server started, because at this point, all the migrations will be run in the actual server on startup, then I'm going to go ahead and say DB connection dot open async, and then responder equals await responder dot create async. And this is where I'm going to pass down my DB connection first. So DB connection goes here, and then my configuration. So responder options. Now you can configure quite a few things here, but the important ones are the adapters. So you're going to say that, yes, this is going to be a Postgres adapter because I have a Postgres database. And now you can say things like, schemas to exclude or schemas to include, database schemas, or tables to ignore or tables to include. So you can go ahead and have an array and say, I want this table to be respond, ignore this other table. You have full configuration over the important things. Now, in my case, I want to just say schemas to include and pass down the public schema, which is where my customer's database is under. And that's it. That's all the configuration I need. Now I'm just going to extract this to do a bit of a refactoring because I don't want to have everything in there without any meaning. So initialize responder goes here, just a private method. And then the other thing I want to do is I want to give a public method for my test. So public async task reset database async, and my tests after each test will call this. So all I'm going to say is await responder dot reset async. The methods it has is reset SQL or delete SQL, so you can actually see the SQL generated, or reset async, and then I'm going to pass down a connection, and that's it. Now all I need to do for this to work in my tests is go ahead and implement the iAsync lifetime interface, because I want something to happen on dispose async, basically after each test. So the initialize async bit, I don't care. I'm just going to leave it as it is. But the dispose async is where I'm going to point to the reset method. Now, I have a couple of approaches I can deal with this. First would be obviously to create a private read-only customer API factory and then map it here and then use the API.reset database async method. But I don't want to expose the full thing. So I'm going to go just pass the function and say func of task, that is reset database, and that's it. And then in here, all I'm going to say is API factory dot reset database async and point to the function. And then at the bottom, all I'm going to do is this, and that's it. I'm going to go ahead and do this now for every single one of my tests. So delete will get the same treatment. And of course, I'm going to remove in get all everything I had before. I no longer need that. And over here, and over here, and off camera, I'm going to do the constructor stuff as well. All right, here we go. And now the same tests that we're passing before, because they could not reuse the same database, I'm going to go ahead and run them and just show you that, yes, we're only going to have one database created. And let's see what happens now. All of them are passing blazing fast, 333 milliseconds from 2.5 seconds with database resetting between the actions. Now, obviously, not much data was created. It's usually a few customers and then deleted. But you can see how painless now resetting the database to a previous state is, and we don't have to worry about any cleanup. It is an amazing library. I highly recommend you give it a star on GitHub. It is absolutely fantastic, and I recommend it to everyone who's writing integration tests. But what do you think? How are you managing deleting test data for your own integration tests? Leave a comment down below. Well, that's all I had for you for this video. Thank you very much for watching. Special thanks to my Patreons for making this as possible. If you want to support us, you're going to find the link in the description down below. Leave a like if you like this video, subscribe more, click the like, and share the bell as well. And I'll see you in the next video. Keep coding.